This is WKTV Journal. In focus today is Grand Rapids-based Migrant Legal Aid. Protecting migrant workers' legal rights is the focus of director and attorney Teresa Hendricks and attorney Ben O'Hearn. Migrant Legal Aid also works with local farmers and agribusiness to resolve legal disputes involving migrant workers. With the continuing confusion that is current federal immigration policy, a policy that includes the separation of families, America's migrant labor force and farmers are seeking clarity. We wanted to talk to people in the know. Thank you both for being here. Now you're working with Migrant Legal Aid. What is the state of illegal immigration in Michigan right now? Are a lot of the, you work primarily with migrant laborers who are legal, but there, do you know how many people are here illegally in Michigan?
So what we work with is the migrant population that harvests the fruits and vegetables in Michigan, and there are about 94,000 migrant workers and family members that come here every year to harvest. And it's generally accepted that about 50% of them are undocumented, and we represent both. It doesn't matter if they're documented or undocumented. We tend to represent more of the undocumented population.
Because they're the ones who are more frequently asking for help?
And they seem to be victimized easier, and they're more isolated and need more protection. They're very vulnerable.
They don't have much legal recourse, do they?
They do, but not as much as somebody with yeah. lawful status. So, for example, they're not allowed to be enslaved. If they've already worked, they're allowed to have a claim for the hours that they worked, for example.
Yeah. Additionally, there are limitations on federal funding for other legal services groups. So if you are here and you're undocumented, then the options at your usual legal aid organization can be pretty slim. Because there's a federal restriction saying that if you receive money from the federal government for legal services, then you cannot represent undocumented persons. And so we don't have that restriction ourselves. So historically, a lot of those cases that traditional legal aid groups wouldn't be able to do, they would refer to us.
And you don't have that restriction because of your funding sources?
Correct. We don't receive money through the Legal Services Corporation grant.
Your money comes from where?
Pretty much wherever we can get it. It's not the federal government.
We write grants, and so they come from foundations, from donor support, from sponsorships.
Okay. All right. So because it's not, none of it's government money, then the restriction's not there. Is that correct?
We don't have that particular restriction that traditional legal services groups have.
Okay. Now, how does one become a legal migrant worker?
Literally, the only way to become a legal migrant worker for the general population is to not be in the United States when you want to become a legal migrant worker. The way that a lot of employers are finding legal help now is through the H-2A program, which requires bringing up guest workers, historically from Mexico, but any other country, to come to the United States for a nine-month period, or up to a nine-month period, to work for a particular employer and then return back home.
The H-2A?
Yeah, it's a particular part of the immigration law that allows these short-term guest workers to come up to help out with agriculture.
Okay.
If you're here already and you're undocumented, then the odds of you finding a way to become a legal worker are pretty slim, unless you're the victim of violence or human trafficking. The odds of becoming a legal farm worker are very, very slim. Mm.
Okay, so legal migrant labor has to get the job basically outside the United States before they come here.
If you're not already a U.S. citizen.
Yeah. And so, blueberry farmers here would go to Central America to recruit employees? Is that how it works?
Well, that's the scary part. They usually won't do it themselves. They'll use some sort of middleman. And the safety and well-being of the actual farm worker comes down to how honest that middleman is. I don't think most farmers feel comfortable navigating the complex Department of Labor and Homeland Security requirements that they'd have to do to bring someone up from a foreign country, so they rely on someone who's got a lot more experience. But whether that person is honest and upfront with the workers.
So kind of third-party headhunters do the hiring. And that also probably lessens the legal liability on the farmer, since they're not the ones technically doing the hiring?
That's what they're trying to accomplish.
Okay.
The only other way to become a legal farm worker is if you are here undocumented and you marry a legal permanent resident or a citizen, and they can petition for you. But that depends on your background as well. So if you have a prior order of removal or order of deportation, that can complicate things. And you might be facing a 10-year bar or not be able to come back at all. So there's very limited avenues, and even a family-based petition that could get you an employment authorization, it takes a lot of analysis of your background before you can figure out if you're eligible or not.
So it's difficult. So someone who applies for this job, these recruiters who go to Central America recruiting migrant farmer labor, they apply, do they, what kind of requirements are they asking for? Are they just anyone who's willing to work at that pay? Is there any documentation that they have to show, or?
The pay is usually set by the Department of Labor. They will come up with a wage rate that in theory will discourage farmers from recruiting foreign workers at the expense of local workers. So for example, for this year, the minimum wage for an H-2A laborer is $13.06 an hour.
That's not bad.
Yeah, but no overtime.
I mean, it's not exactly work I'd want to do, but still,
and that's
I guess it pays better than McDonald's.
If you get paid for every hour worked, and that's where the problem comes in. When you have a labor broker in the middle who's getting paid by the landowner and then has to pass through the money to the farm worker who's afraid to complain, because if they complain, they can get sent back. So that's where you find a lot of the discrepancies.
So the third-party headhunters may be skimming off the top there.
We've seen that many times.
Okay, so there may be that, just because that's what the law requires them to get paid doesn't necessarily mean that's what they're getting paid.
Right, and the minimum wage in Michigan is $9.25 an hour. And so the idea of having a higher wage rate if you're going to bring someone from another country is to incentivize a grower to hire here, somebody here first.
So that incentive doesn't appear to be working.
It does not appear to be working, because when the H-2A laborers come over, they also do not have the same federal protections under labor law that somebody who's a domestic worker here would have.
Which does suggest that the law is being violated somewhere, right? Because if they really were being paid $13.25, you would think that they would find Michiganders willing to do it.
You would think so. There are very different techniques for pretending you can't find a U.S. worker that they have to go through. For example, they put an ad out for workers, put it at a time when you know you're not going to have a lot of audience, or describe the job in such a way that you encourage no one to apply for it, or you run a very short ad. I mean, it's kind of a known thing, and some of the employers go to conferences where they're told, this is how you pretend to look for U.S. workers.
Yeah, wow. I mean, this seems to be really where the government could do more if it wanted to crack down on these illegal efforts, and that would seem to be more effective to me, that do something about illegal immigrants coming to the United States than building a wall, for example. Which
yes, so if you think about it, if you're promising to bring someone over here and pay them $13 an hour and promising 50 hours a week, but that doesn't happen and they end up working for free for 30 some hours, that's actually slavery. And it's kind of considered legalized slavery because they brought them here legally. So the government actually contributes to the vulnerability of these workers. And the U.S. Department of Labor will be good at enforcing any of those violations if the workers dare to come forward and if the investigator is talented and knows what to look for. But the U.S. Department of Labor has barred some of these labor contractors from being able to bring labor over for these types of violations. The problem is it's easy enough for their relative to get a farm labor contractor license and just start up a successive organization and continue to do the same thing.
Yeah. Well, I always thought that if the, you know, for those who were really upset about all the illegal immigrants here, which I don't think is personally that big of a problem, but it would seem like the best way to handle it would have to be the government cracking down on the businesses that are hiring them and through all of these dubious activities, rather than the cruel policies that we're seeing now at the border with the family separations and the prosecuting of everybody in the United States as a criminal who's here illegally. What are you seeing along these lines? Is that impacting the migrant laborers in Michigan, and to what extent?
Everybody lives in fear right now because, as you know, there have been raids in Michigan and other parts of the country, but we've had what the people call raids in, you know, Ypsilanti, Ann Arbor, Monroe, and in West Michigan. And then you also have a lot of enforcement in parking lots. And so families are living right now terrified of going out into public. We have parents that have said, we don't dare to go to our child's parent-teacher conference. We don't dare to drive anywhere or go to, for example, a Walmart parking lot, because often you'll see ICE patrol there. They don't want to go to public gatherings. Sometimes their children who are entitled to benefits, they will forego those because they don't want to be seen going to some government office. So what is happening right now is it's pushed these families with mixed immigration status, meaning some people in the family are citizens and some are not. It's pushed them further underground, and they're now much less likely to be brave enough to assert any rights. And bullying in schools, we've seen an increase in things like, you know, saying your dad's going to get sent home, or you'll have to go away when the wall gets built, or just general bullying in school. I know in Lansing there was an instance where a gentleman was held down and a note stapled to his chest, and it said, go home. And he had been a resident and a worker of Ingham County for some 17 years. So a lot of increase in hate, a lot of increase in intolerance, and a lot of harassment.
Yeah, I mean, I see this anti-immigrant hysteria that President Trump has ridden successfully politically. It was my understanding, and maybe I'm wrong, you can correct me, but I thought immigration or illegal immigration was actually down compared to past years. Where are we with that? Is the hysteria matching the problem, or is illegal immigration stayed the same and perhaps gone down?
So I think that immigration and illegal immigration has fluctuated over the years, but there's more hysteria than reality. And in fact, if we want laborers to pick our fruits and vegetables, we have to have foreign labor. So there's really an easy path forward. And it was all set up prior to 9/11 in a bipartisan bill that would have allowed a path to legalization, and that got derailed. There was a bill.
Is that the Dream Act you're referring to?
No, that one was called Ag Jobs.
Okay.
And then there was another one, Kennedy-McCain, and those were very well thought out bipartisan efforts to make sure that we are bringing in the labor, that we're giving them a path to legalization, but we're also increasing border security. And I think that's what our country needs to get back to, because people say it's too complicated, we can't fix it. Yes, we can. It was already designed. We need to go back and look at that. It's a treasure trove of how to fix the situation right now, if there's the will to do it. You need the political will to do that.
So you're saying there's a bipartisan solution in Congress that's been there for some time, but politically the two sides can't make it work?
Yes, before Kennedy died, he worked very hard with McCain in coming up with a solution to have this path for legalizing our workers. And look, our baby boomers are retiring. We need people paying into the system. You know, the undocumented workers, they pay taxes. They pay Social Security. You know, they pay into the system. And the only time they'll ever get back from the system is if they file their tax return and they are entitled to some kind of return. And they all want to file taxes, because whenever there is a chance to legalize, they have to prove that they've been paying taxes, almost all the programs. So the government gives them a W-7 form, an individual taxpayer identification number, to pay taxes with. And that's what people don't realize. A lot of the government offices want to pretend that they're not here or that they're not working. And the IRS is smarter than that, and they say, we know they're here, we know they're working. Here's a form, fill it out. Here's how you pay your taxes.
Hey, well, thank you both for being here today. Really appreciate it.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
This has been WKTV Journal In Focus. I'm Keith St. Clair. Thanks to our guests, and thanks to you for joining us today. And remember, learn more, get involved.